For this assignment, you're going to draw an illustration of the star life cycle. Now, even though we know stars aren't actually alive, they're born from their cloud of gas and dust, the nebula, they evolve and change over time, and they die in different ways depending on how large they were when they lived. You'll just need a piece of printer paper turned sideways. Title it Star Life Cycle and draw and label what I draw. We're going to start out with our nebula. Remember, our nebula is just a cloud of gas and dust. This is a very disorganized mass of material out in space that probably came as a result of another star exploding. We talked about the nebular theory back in the last unit. What happens is as these particles start to get squeezed by gravity, what we end up seeing is this kind of pattern of concentric circles inside of circles. So, as all of this material squeezed by gravity gets pulled into the center and this material starts to orbit around each other, we're eventually going to get a little baby star accreting in the center of this disk. The star at this point is called a protostar. Proto in Greek means first. So we're just about to the point where we call this star a true star. Now, star birth is considered to occur when nuclear fusion begins. Now remember, this nuclear fusion is what happens when we have those four individual hydrogen atoms that get crammed together so quickly under immense heat and pressure that they actually become helium atoms. This process occurs in every single star, no matter what. Now we're going to begin to diverge a little bit and have a couple of different patterns depending on the size of the star. Let's start out with a star that is small to medium-sized, like the Sun. We're going to take this pattern down the right-hand side of our page. Our Sun is going to live for about 10 billion years before it starts to run out of fuel. We will continue fusing hydrogen to helium for this 10 billion year time period, but eventually the amount of hydrogen left in the Sun is going to run out. So the Sun has no choice but to try to start fusing helium atoms together. It will be able to do this for a while, but using heavier atoms means that the temperature of the star is going to increase. That means it's going to change from being a small to medium-sized star, and it's going to expand and become a red giant. This star is going to be so large that it will actually end up eating the Earth. It'll eat Mercury, eat Venus, eat probably at least to the orbit where Earth is, and start expanding out toward Mars. And again, the reason why it's starting to expand into this new stage is because it's fusing heavier and heavier atoms, like carbon and oxygen. So the heliums become carbons, and the carbons fuse with additional heliums and become oxygen. But at some point, the Sun is not going to be able to sustain this either. It just doesn't have enough power. At that point, the Sun is then going to collapse, and it's going to shrink down to be about the size of Earth, and this star is called a white dwarf. Now remember, white dwarfs are small, white-colored stars. You could compare a match that's been blown out. Sometimes you see that little glowing ember still there. It's still hot, and it's still releasing light, but it's not really on fire anymore, and it will continue to radiate energy out into space for a while longer until it actually becomes what's called a black dwarf. This black dwarf means that our Sun is now totally dead. This is what happens in the case of a very average star like the Sun, small to medium sized, but remember, not every star is the same size. So this path is characteristic of relatively small to medium sized stars, but there's another path for larger stars. These stars that start out much larger, either as giant or supergiant stars, have a very different way that they actually die. They are so much more powerful because of their immense amount of gravity due to their mass. They can actually continue undergoing fusion up until the element iron, symbol Fe, which is atomic number 26. Any element smaller up into and including iron are actually formed in stars in their giant or supergiant stage. But the problem is that once we get to iron, fusion actually requires energy rather than releases energy, and so the star becomes unstable and will explode. This type of star explosion is called a supernova. These star explosions are incredibly bright, and they occur at the death of stars. In this particular situation, this is a type 2 supernova. There are other types of supernova as well. Fusion in large stars produces elements up to and including the mass of iron. But any element that is larger than iron is actually formed in these supernova explosions. So anything between iron, atomic number 26, and uranium, atomic number 92, which is the heaviest naturally occurring element in the universe, are formed when stars explode and then collapse in on themselves. Now, there are two final paths that we can follow, and it depends on the mass of the star when it started out. Stars that are about 10 times the size of the Sun when they start to die will collapse down to become a neutron star. The reason why these are called neutron stars is because the positive protons and the negative electrons in the atoms of the stars themselves are actually compressed so tightly that they actually become neutrons. This star is literally just a big bunch of neutrons, and it's very small and very, very dense. When I say very small, I mean the size of a city as opposed to the size of a planet or a star. Some of these neutron stars spin very, very quickly and are called pulsars. That's one path. Now there's another remaining option for the largest stars, and these largest stars have very, very strange deaths indeed. These stars actually collapse into what's called a black hole, and you've probably heard of these. These stars have collapsed down so tight, so dense, that light cannot even escape it. Now this is pretty amazing to think about, because light travels at 186,282 miles per second. And even at that speed, light is still not fast enough to escape a black hole. No light can escape, and so that's why they're called a black hole. You can't see them because the only way you're actually able to see something is how light reflects off of it. Now, a lot of times people ask what would happen if something flew into a black hole. Well, this is one of my favorite words. What happens is called spaghettification. Imagine yourself flying Superman style into a black hole. Your hands will actually accelerate faster than your feet because they're closer to the star. You would actually become elongated, becoming more and more and more and more stretched apart until you're basically ripped atom from atom. I would think it would be a pretty painful way to go, so my advice would be not to go flying into any black hole that you happen to see. The good thing is that there are not any black holes anywhere near our part of the solar system, or our part of the galaxy for that matter, so the chances of you running into one are basically none. When your drawing's complete, snap a photo and upload it to Canvas to get your points.